Hey, welcome to the Weekly Fury. I'm Josh.
And I'm Sean.
It's a whole nother week, and we got a lot more topics to get into. And we're going to start things off right off the bat with Ezekiel Elliott. Sean, no, your boy. He was at a St. Patrick's Day parade, and he sees this chick right next to him, and he reaches over and pulls down her shirt, exposing her tits to the whole crowd. Now, Sean, now you know how the NFL is with their, you know, personal conduct policy, and you know Ezekiel Elliott is already under the microscope with the NFL with those domestic charges and allegations that he was facing from a year ago. Yep. Now, what's up with your boy, man? What's he doing? He knows he's under a microscope. What's going on with your boy, man? What's going on with Zeke?
I was really hoping we wouldn't include this in this topics. All right, so
I mean, you can't go around just you know, exposing chicks to some fucking tits.
I need a drink for this one. All right, so first off, I want to get this out of the way, okay? Zeke Elliott, he is just, you know, having fun, just like he's just out having fun, just like a typical guy his age would be. At a, you know, St. Patty's Parade or what is it, Mardi Gras or whatever.
Yeah, but you can't go do that. Having fun,
but he isn't a typical kid. You know, he's not a typical guy at his age. He's representing, he's a role model, and I don't agree with what he did. Now, don't get me wrong. There's a lot of players that go out there, go to the clubs, they party it up, they do stuff. Look at D Rose, what he did. Just saying. Mm-hmm. So this stuff happens all the time. But you don't go out there, especially in a parade, and in the middle where you know there's a bunch of cameras on you, and you already know you are, like you said, under the microscope from the NFL. It's like, I want to shake my head because I look at it as like, yeah, it's not a big deal because it's a kid, but at the same time, it is a big deal because the NFL can, it's like you said, conduct policy, right? And we cannot be without this kid. He is the focal point of our offense. And if we don't have him, oh, man, it's a little disappointing. And it sucks. He's going to have to grow up a little bit. And I'm not, like, shocked that he did it, but I don't, just because of his age. I know it's weird, but it's...
So, here's my thoughts on Zeke, man.
Look, yeah.
You know, he really needs to grow up. He can't keep doing this shit, you know? His own father, last year, he came out and he said, you know, his biggest worry is that his son doesn't know how to navigate in life as a superstar. Because, you know, everyone is young and stupid and makes terrible mistakes, right? And he seems like he's really wanting to do that, like just, you know, party it up and everything. But at the same time, you know, he's playing for America's team, Dallas Cowboys, and he's a superstar for that team, America's team. So anything he does is going to be out there. And Zeke, you know, he's being carefully watched by the NFL. There was talks of him being suspended for something that he probably didn't do at all, but that's how the NFL is. It, you know, to them, if you even look guilty, you're guilty. Kind of like with Big Ben. You know, he had those allegations against him. He wasn't found guilty or anything like that. No wrongdoing, you know, in court or whatever. But Roger Goodell, it didn't matter to him. He came out and he said, no, I did, even if a player, you know, didn't violate a law, you know, you're held to a certain standard as an NFL player. And if you don't, you know, look like you're playing that role, we'll suspend your ass. And Zeke, you know, he's got to get his shit together because he can't go. This could have turned so ugly so fast. That his representative said that it was all in good fun and the woman wasn't upset. Now, that's bullshit. Okay, because what if that woman was upset? What if she turned around and said, oh my God, I can't believe he just reached down and grabbed my pulled my shirt down? And what if she would have contacted the authorities? And there's video proof, so there's no like he said, she said. And that could have been a sexual assault because he you know, he grabs her shirt and exposes her to a whole bunch of people. And you're looking at, you know, him possibly going to jail or getting suspended for a long period of time in the NFL. that quick, it could have turned ugly. So he really, you know, he's young, and you know, and he's
right.
You know, people make mistakes when they're young, but you know, he's in a different place than what most people
absolutely right
that age are.
And it sucks, like, because I understand he's wanting to be a kid and go out there and do stupid shit like that, but he's got to understand he is Ezekiel Elliott.
And his like own father.
I try to figure out, and that's why I was trying to go through all these different things and try to understand why he would do it. But it's just because he's a kid and
he's just having fun. He's just trying to have fun. In his mind, he doesn't think what he's doing is
he's like
all
on
that
top
wrong.
Of clouds right now. He's on top of the clouds. None of the shit's really like the shit that has happened, you know, with the allegations and stuff. Nothing's hit the fan yet. So he doesn't know the consequences of his actions because this is college. Colleges, we already know, sweep shit under the rug and say, oh, no, you'll be okay. Just go play football and win his games. That's how college is. They don't care. But when you get to the NFL, especially right now, the NFL is already scrutinized for every little thing they do.
With Roger Goodell as commissioner?
They're trying to find anything they can do to throw blame onto the players. And that's what sucks about the NFL. And like you said, Roger Goodell, he can do what the fuck he wants. That's part of this. That's part of his pretty much his job description.
Yeah.
He can suspend anybody if they feel like it's necessary. So it sucks, but you know, hopefully he'll learn from this. Hopefully.
Did you know that his father had to live right nearby him in college? That's how worried he is for him. Like
he followed.
I think he tried to do the same thing when he moved here. When he came to Dallas, you know. So in my mind, I think you know Ezekiel Elliott is. You know, he wants to go out and have fun, and he thinks he's invincible. And he better be really careful because he will find out by Roger Goodell that he isn't. I mean, who knows what's still to come of this? You know, and remember how earlier, you know. About a month ago when it first popped up that what if Adrian Peterson came to the Dallas Cowboys, right? You know, is that so crazy now? Because what if Ezekiel Elliott, he does something else like this and he gets suspended and it could be for a long time. Do the Dallas Cowboys need to go out there and get themselves a legitimate running back insurance?
Josh, don't be throwing that shit out there like that.
Do they? I mean,
I see what you're doing. I see. Okay.
You know, do they? Do the Cowboys have something to worry about with Ezekiel Elliott?
I wouldn't say just yet. What they should do is obviously the veterans on the team, which I already know Jason Witten will say something. Dez Bryant probably needs to step up, which he probably will. Dez Bryant's gotten a lot more mature. I know a lot of people think he's still a hothead, but he's matured a lot over the years. But you know, give it another – see if he can learn from this, you know? We have to see how he's going to respond. But I think a key part of this is going to be Dak Prescott. I want to see what Dak Prescott's on. He is leader of the team.
That's what he should be hanging out with like all the time.
He's a very humble guy. Dak is very humble. He doesn't do much. And I think Dak needs to maybe – and Dak and Zeke are like best friends, right? We saw that throughout the whole season. And so I think Dak maybe needs to take him pull him closer and just say, "Hey man, let's focus," you know? Because especially on America's team, we all know this. Like whatever you do, you're going to get scrutinized. Look, we have that in Romo. Romo did great for us, but any kind of mistake he made, especially on the field, he was scrutinized for. Even when he was dating Jessica Simpson, he got scrutinized. Oh, he's dating her. He sucks now, you know? So they will look at every single thing, and if Ezekiel fucks up, they're going to blame it, you know?
So,
and you don't want to add that extra pressure.
So, yeah, you know, Zeke, you know, he's a young guy. He just needs to mature a little bit, and then he'll be fine because he's too good of a player to, you know, get himself into any kind of dumb player.
It's a great time.
Stupid, you know, trouble or anything.
He'll learn. He'll learn.
He's a good guy. Just needs to grow up. All right. So – the Dallas Cowboys, Sean, I want you to describe to me in one word the Dallas Cowboys free agency this offseason.
One word?
Yeah. In one word, describe the Dallas Cowboys free agency.
Shit. Yeah.
Okay. Why do you think it's been shit?
Because there's no urgency, you know?
Right.
All right. Any Cowboy fans out there, you know, if you're smart, you know we weren't going to go out there and get a big-time free agent. I wasn't naive about that. Me and you talked about this, Josh. I didn't expect us to go out and get Calais Campbell or A.J. Boye or Stephon Gilmore or all these big-name free agents. No, I didn't expect that. You know, we don't have the cap space. We don't. And so I understood we were going to lose Church. I knew we were probably going to lose
Brandon Carr.
I was kind of hoping we might try to bring back Claiborne because he was good for us when he was healthy last year.
Right.
And he left too. So we're pretty much down two corners. And honestly, we need to do something. We need to, there's talks about Richard Sherman being on the trading block. I'm not sure what Seattle really wants for him. We do need a shutdown corner. I think that's a big thing we've been missing in our defense. That will actually help out our pass rush because if you can make that quarterback hold the ball a little bit longer, that pass rush can get there. And vice versa. If we get a really good pass rush, we can have a shitty secondary. So it kind of plays hand in hand. So we need to do something. We did get a defensive tackle. So we did sign some players. And we did. I'm honestly surprised we signed Terrence Williams back. I thought he was gone for sure. But we got him back, so I thought that was great.
Yeah, you signed Stephen Peya,
tackle. Peya. That's who
Nolan
it was.
Nolan Carroll. You guys signed Nolan Carroll. Montre Moore.
Yeah. Nolan Carroll. He's got some potential. He had a good year or so, and then he's been kind of, you know, mediocre or bad.
Yeah.
So hopefully he can, you know, get his shit together, because I think he was a great talent when he went to Philly. He was actually pretty good, and we'll see what he can do in Dallas, but I think we're going to have to – we don't have a lot of cap space, so I'm not naive. I understand we're not going to make those big splashes. So what I think is going to happen is we're going to have to do it all in the draft, man. Our free agency is not looking great until we get rid of some of these big contracts. So,
well, there you go. Have it from a Dallas Cowboys fan. To me, yeah. I would sum up the Dallas Cowboys free agency as meh. I mean, you know – Barry
That's
Church,
not a word, Josh.
It is in my world. Barry Church, Brandon Carr, Morris Claiborne, J.J. Wilcox, all those guys that you guys lost in free agency, they all combine a total of zero Pro Bowls between them all. So, like, you know.
That's why I was okay.
Really miss these guys? You know, I mean, and
I was expecting them to be gone. I was. Only person I wanted back is Mo Claiborne. That's it.
And these guys that you guys signed, these guys are like, I see them as placeholders. They're not terrible players. They're not great players. They're just somebody to fill in the space. They're, you know, meh.
Yeah,
and meh. So, I mean, and the Cowboys, you know, to the Cowboys fans, you know, because I live here around the Dallas area, and I hear a lot of them, you know, bitch about how the Cowboys should have went after Calais Campbell. They should have went after Gilmore or Boye, and they don't understand that you guys only had $7 million in cap space going into free agency.
There's no way we can sign these guys.
So there wasn't much room, you know, to work with there. So, you know. So Dallas Cowboys got some work to do on defense, and like you were saying, they will have to do it through draft. Now another thing that's you know, the big elephant in the room with Dallas Cowboys and free agency is what are they gonna do about Tony Romo? I mean, he's gonna get cut. He's going to get traded. He's going back to being cut.
You know, we were really hoping that something would fucking happen by now.
Everyone thought so. Tell us why they haven't though.
Because they don't have to. There's no rush. And
business side of it makes sense, right?
Yeah, and a lot of fans have been getting frustrated. I'm frustrated in a sense of that I want to know.
You want to know where Romo's going, right?
Yeah. But at the end of the day, I understand what they're doing because they have all of the power right now. If a team really wants them, trade for them. Or we could be patient and hold on to them. And you know what? That's going to make them either force some moves or really see how serious these teams are. So Houston, Denver, and we'll go from there. What this can do is if these other teams, and this actually works out for Romo's benefit too, because of this fact. Say the Houston Texans or Denver Broncos, they're like, okay, we really want Romo. Okay. Cowboys hold on to Romo, try to trade him. Okay, maybe they don't get the trade done. But they wait like 2-3 more weeks. And then all these other quarterbacks are picked up. Jay Cutler's to the Jets, or Geno Smith got signed to the Giants. What happens? The market is shrinking. Mm-hmm. That's better. When you don't have other options out there to compete with you, that means your value does go up a little bit. No, I'm not saying he's going to get a huge contract, but that does help him out because be like, hey, motherfuckers, if you don't sign me, what other options you got? So it kind of helps him in a sense in if these teams are really that serious.
Now, Houston came out and said that they're fine with Savage. They're comfortable with Savage being their starting quarterback. I don't know how much truth there is to that. They're
just saying that.
There is to that, but you know, like this Romo situation, it makes sense from the business side of it, which means to tell me that that Jerry Jones doesn't have all his fingers over it. I mean, you're going to expect me that Jerry Jones kind of grew up with that stuff? Because Jerry Jones likes it. He really, really loves his players, and he likes to take care of them. If this was like 5 years ago or whatever, Jerry Jones would have taken care of Romo and did the best for him, right? Yeah. But to me, this has more so to do with his son. Like, Steven? Like, because, you know, because they love Tony Romo, but they're really focusing on the business side of it, and their main focus isn't Tony Romo's future, you know, and the, you know, in business side, that makes sense. And that's
why I've been talking about this for years, and I've been telling you before we started this channel that I really feel like Steven Jones is actually more of the puppet master in the background.
Pulling the strings, right?
While Jerry Jones is more the guy in the media just, you know, blabbering it up. Because how many times have you heard Jerry say something and then the Cowboys come back and Steven's like, no. and you see that. And I love it, though. I do love it because ever since Steven Jones kind of became more integrated into that franchise, we've been drafting better. We built one of the best offensive lines out there. I think he's very – you know, we got Tyron Smith. I think when he first started kind of getting integrated, Tyron Smith was one of our top ones. Him and Jason Garrett, I think, really came together and said, let's build this team. And they've been really patient, and it's worked. And we have one of the best offensive lines. We were smart enough to get Ezekiel last year, even though everybody was like, oh, you got to go defense. You got to go defense. Jalen Ramsey, remember? Everybody wanted us to pick him. And they're really smart. They're playing it smart, and they're not just looking at it. Because you're right, Jerry Jones would already let him go. Jerry Jones overpays for players. They're not doing that anymore. You know, we didn't sign Barry Church to this huge, massive contract. We let Brandon Carr go because his contract was ridiculous for and stuff like that. So they're being smart. So don't overpay. Be patient, and things will happen.
But eventually, they will have to make a decision with Tony Romo because he cannot be on that roster.
Oh, he won't. He will not be.
That's not going to happen. It's time for the new era, Dak Prescott era, and it's going to be a good one for you guys, for the Cowboys fan base to witness for the next, 10, 12 seasons. So those are our thoughts on the Dallas Cowboys free agency. You guys let us know what you guys think about the Dallas Cowboys free agency. Are you upset with what they've been doing? How would you describe the Cowboys free agency? Let us know in the comments down below. So anyway, moving on. The New England Patriots. Now, this is something that I've heard earlier this week, right?
I like this topic.
It's very interesting. I think it was brought up on First Take. I don't know. One of those shows. It was brought up that the New England Patriots, Belichick and Brady, are they – is Belichick gearing up for both of their last act for the New England Patriots? Not just Brady, because he's about to be 40 here soon, if he's not 40 already, I'm sure somebody will let us know in the comments down below. But but anyway, we know Brady's his time is coming up soon. But I think these moves, could this mean that Belichick is also preparing for the end for himself? Because look at it. The Patriots, like we talked about in our other Patriots video, the Patriots are doing things that they've never done before. They went and got Stephon Gilmore, the best defensive player on the market. They trade for Brandon Cooks. They get Dwayne Allen. They re-signed Dante Hightower earlier this week. So, they're making these moves that they don't ever do. So, Sean, do you think there's truth to this, that Belichick and Brady are going to both go out to the sunset together in this next, what, year or two? And that's why they're making these moves. They killed the offseason. They won the Super Bowl. They killed. They destroyed the offseason. And they're looking like they could probably be the first team, maybe, to win three championships in a row, three Super Bowls in a row. That'd be the first time that's ever happened. Do you think this is the end for Belichick as well as Brady? And that's why these moves are happening.
Yeah. And you're talking about like three in a row, like from this next year and the year after?
Yeah, because they've already won this last year, then won next year, and then the year after that. But at least one Super Bowl, right? Get at least one Super Bowl in the next 2 years, because they are, you know, they're making moves like they have to win now.
You know, I really see that, you know, I didn't really think about it. We talked about this in our last Patriots video, and we're like, dude, what the fuck is going on?
We've never seen this.
Shocking. We've never seen this. And I'm mind blown. I'm at the bar, and I'm just like, Brandon Cooks? And I'm like looking around, and I had to drink like five beers. Mm-hmm. Because I was just dumbfounded, and I was depressed because the Patriots just won the Super Bowl, and now they're probably still one of the best teams, if not the best team, with all the additions. So, and it's frustrating, but, you know, hats off to them, because every year we see Belichick let these linebackers go.
He's not scared to.
He's not. He's like, you know
what? He trades for draft picks.
He trades for draft picks. Oh, look at Chandler Jones. He was one of the best linebackers in the game. And he traded him off. What the hell?
This is different now.
And it's different. Now he's like, you know what, Dante Hightower? Come back. The only linebacker that I can remember in recent years that were still in their prime that he gave a contract to was Teddy Bruschi. He loved Teddy Bruschi. He calls him the true patriot, right? Yeah. That's the only guy, and even on offense, Brady's the only guy that they've really kept around or given a big contract to, really. And especially gotten and the other players that they brought in that were big names was Randy Moss, all these guys, but they were out of their prime already.
And they were they were gone shortly thereafter.
They just traded for Brandon Cooks, who hasn't even gotten his major contract yet. So that means that they're going to – they traded for him knowing, like, hey, he's about to be, what, a free agent, I think, in another year or so?
Yeah.
I don't know exactly his contract, but they're going to have to pay him. Like, why trade for him if you're not going to give him that big contract, right?
Because they want to win now.
They're going to give him that. Why? They're not going to give up draft picks for that. So it's like all these moves kind of are pointing towards maybe the ride off to the Hunt sunset. And I would love it because I think Bill Belichick's going to hand it off to Matt Patricia and he's going to take over that team. And that team's going to be fucking great. And I'm in shock and it sucks balls hardcore.
But you know what?
I got to pay respect.
But, yeah, you got to respect the Patriots, and you got to recognize that Tom Brady, he's the greatest quarterback of all time. You got to recognize that Bill Belichick.
I hate saying it, but it's true.
He's the greatest coach of all time. And they're both together in this era, and they're about – it looks like they're about to have their swan song, as they say, and go off into the sunset with another Super Bowl, maybe two. Who knows? Maybe what if they do a three-peat? Imagine greatest quarterback and greatest coach of all time go off in the sunset with a three-peat Super Bowl. Never happened. And that'll be something that will never – I mean, they're already the greatest, but they're literally going to build statues all of those guys everywhere. All over the country. Patriots fans –
That trophy, the Lombardi trophy, is going to be called the Belichick trophy. Yeah,
probably. Shit, all those times he's won it. Who fucked, man?
Goodness gracious.
But anyway, Patriots fans, as well as, you know, not just Patriots fans, but all fans of football and the NFL, you know, I know people out there really hate the Patriots. They can't stand Belichick and Brady, but you got to respect what it is that they do.
Yeah.
The you know, the level of coaching, the gameplay of Tom Brady. You got to admire it. You got to respect it. And you're witnessing. You got to witnessing the greatest coach and greatest quarterback of all time, and enjoy it because it seems like, you know, it may not last long.
This is a once in a lifetime, dude.
Yeah,
it really is.
So even if you hate him, you're gonna think back 10, 20 years from now, like, man, wasn't it fucking awesome to fucking root against the goddamn Patriots? I loved hating them. Whatever it is. But you got to respect them and enjoy their probably the last couple of years together in the NFL. So, you guys let us know what you think about the Patriots move. Do you think this is going to be their last act? this next year or yeah. two. Let us know what you guys think.
Josh, how many comments are we gonna have about them being cheaters?
Oh shit.
We're gonna have like
I don't 20. Know, man. Fuck.
I don't know. That's always the biggest argument, but you know, that's another story. But let's move on.
Goats. All right. So the Seattle Seahawks, they go from beast mode to feast mode. They signed Eddie Lacy this week. And check this out, dude. Like, first off, the jokes beast are mode. Endless. The fucking fat jokes are endless. I mean, I don't know if you've heard them, but I mean, this guy.
I see memes all the time.
I mean, you know how Marshawn Lynch, he goes in the end zone, he eats Skittles. Yeah. Eddie Lacy's going to go in the end zone, he's going to be eating double cheeseburgers from McDonald's. But, check, man, so, all right, do you think Eddie Lacy is the right fit with the Seattle Seahawks? Is this a good marriage together?
You know, if any team can maybe bring out the best out of Eddie Lacy, I'm actually liking this.
Pete Carroll?
Yes, I like Pete Carroll, and
he's
like that
offense. He's a positive guy.
And Russell Wilson's a true leader. And I'm not saying Aaron Rodgers isn't, but Russell Wilson's a little bit different type. You know, Aaron Rodgers is like real business-oriented, right? He's like, we're going to go
to – too friendly over there in Green Bay with those damn cheeseheads.
Yeah, exactly. Well, but in Seattle, Russell Wilson expects you to be, you know, to get your shit done just like Aaron Rodgers. But he's also like more that – he's going to come pep talk you, you know? So I think it's a good fit. See, Seattle, like you said, they've been – ever since beast mode, they really haven't had a run game at all.
They want a bruising run game. And Eddie Lacy can't give them that.
And I know they have those stipulations in his contract, and maybe that's the key. And say, hey, motherfucker, you want to get those bonuses, you better stay in this weight class.
It's interesting that you brought that up. Let me give out that detail. So he has $385,000 in a weight clause in his contract, okay? And he's got to hit 7 separate benchmarks to get this, each one of them worth $55,000. So he's got to weigh – he weighs 267 pounds. And he's got to weigh 255 pounds by May. In May, he's got to weigh 255. And then in June and August, he has to weigh 250 and stay at 250. And then for the months of September, October, November, December, for most of the season, regular season, he's got to be at 245. So those are the stipulations of his weight clause in his contract. And, you know, I think he can get down there. And he did it before. He lost, you know, quite a bit of weight, you know, with the Green Bay Packers after he gained so much weight. It seems like he's got a problem with motivation. And I think it is a great fit that he goes to Seattle, because Pete Carroll is such a positive guy, you know, and he loves his players. He's very involved with his guys. And he's already come out and said great things about Eddie Lacy. Like, hey, he gives us that kind of running style that we desperately need, that we missed with, you know, since Marshawn Lynch left. And, you know, he believes in him. He's like, hey, I want him to be a big guy. I just get down to around 240. And, you know, I want him to be a big bruising back. And like, okay, you know, I think Pete Carroll can turn this guy and, you know, turn him around, get him healthier,
get him
stay
motivated.
In shape, and be motivated. Yeah. You know, because a lot of people were calling out Eddie Lacy. You know, like Greg Jennings, he came out and he said that that Eddie Lacy was extremely selfish in Green Bay with getting up there in his weight. But, you know, if Eddie Lacy can be motivated and he can turn it around here in Seattle, he's still got a lot of years left in his career.
He's still young.
And that could be a perfect fit, because his style of running is exactly what they're looking for.
Yeah. So that's why I think it's a good fit. I think me and you are both in agreement. As long as he stays motivated, he's good.
Yep. And we'll see if that happens.
I'm excited.
So you guys let us know if you think Eddie Lacy going to Seattle Seahawks was the right move. And do you think he'll stay motivated and get down to 240, 245 and be that kind of north and south runner that Seattle needs?
Show us the don't forget to show us the different memes that y'all might have seen, or different jokes. I want to know, because I've seen a few of them on Facebook, but I want to know more. Like, surprise us. Give us some funny ones.
Yeah, so you guys, let us know in the comments down below. And we'll see how Eddie Lacy turns out in Seattle this next year.
Yeah.
All right. So, Marshawn Lynch was in the news this past week. In regards to the Oakland Raiders, they came out and they said that they are strongly considering a retired Marshawn Lynch joining their roster. But he's fucking retired, though. So how do you strongly consider somebody who's retired? That doesn't make any sense to me.
Honestly, I'm kind of puzzled by this. First off, Marshawn Lynch, and if anybody's really watched or followed football, they know this for a fact. He lost the love of the game, like, at least a year or two before he actually retired. Like, he stopped even caring. Injuries. Yeah, he had injuries.
He's over 30. He's 31. He's going to be 31 in April.
He wouldn't even say one word to the media, hardly. So this guy does not have any motivation to come back and play. He's been traveling the world.
He keeps saying, I'm retired. I'm not coming back.
He's said it multiple times. So I don't think it's going to happen. I don't understand
why this come out. Well, why? The
only thing that makes sense to me, Josh, and I don't know. I just want to throw this out here. Maybe they're doing that to maybe spark these other running backs, like maybe, to maybe lower their price. Maybe they're just like, hey, motherfucker, we possibly might be interested in this other guy over here. And because pretty much Marshawn Lynch, you know, he's a bigger back than AP, but they do have that downhill running style, which Oakland does need. I think they really need that guy that can run through those.
They already got a couple speedy guys, you know, that can pass catch.
Dwayne Washington and all that. So they need that bigger back. And obviously, Marshawn Lynch is bigger, but AP is a great fit for them. Maybe they're trying to use this as like more of a bargaining chip. Like, hey, you know, we're, you know, dangling this over here when it's not really true.
Yeah, I mean,
that's the only thing that's kind of logically going through my head that makes sense.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say next. Like, this equals bad news for Adrian Peterson because it's like, hey, man, nobody's wanting you. You're asking for too much money. And the Oakland Raiders saying, nah, we're fine. We don't need Charles. We don't need Adrian Peterson. We're going to throw it out there in the media that we're interested in a Marshawn Lynch who is retired. Yeah, he lives in Oakland. That would be kind of convenient. Yeah. He's got his store, Beast Mode, that's located right there in Oakland.
Yep.
But he's going to be turning 31 in April. You know, he had injury concerns those last couple of seasons, especially that last season. So I just think, I think you hit it right on the money. I think that's just like a jab to Adrian Peterson saying, you are asking for too much money, so we're going to throw it out there and saying we're more interested in contacting a retired player than talking with you. So come down in price, and maybe we'll talk.
Has AP even had any other scheduled visits?
I don't think he's met with anybody.
Not ever since Oakland.
Yeah, and he should go to Oakland, man. Should go to Oakland. That's a perfect fit. Marshawn Lynch is not coming out of retirement. He's not going to play for the Oakland Raiders. It's not going to happen. I don't see it's going to happen. But
It will not.
No. So you guys let us know in the comments. Do you guys think that this is a ploy by the Oakland Raiders just to get Adrian Peterson to come down in price? Or do you think Marshawn Lynch is actually going to consider coming out of retirement and play for the Raiders next season? So I don't think so, but let us know what you guys think.
Yeah.
And we'll see what happens. All right. So, Sean, March Madness is in full swing. It's here.
What's
you pulled out your bracket?
What's March Madness?
Shit. Don't fucking put on any goddamn sports outlet because March Madness is everywhere. You filled out your bracket,
right? We just lost like 3 subscribers by saying that. No, no, I did. I filled out my bracket. I did.
So did I. All right, so look, Sean, I keep hearing that March Madness is the best time of the year from some people, that it's the best time of the year for sports. I mean, it's a month long tournament pretty much, and it's crazy. It's a crazy tournament with upsets and all kinds of shit going on.
Yeah.
What do you think, man? Do you think this is the best time of the year?
No.
Hell fucking no.
No. Now, I will say this. It is the best time of the year. Now, I want to finish the statement, though. It is the best time of the year to test your luck.
Test your luck and making crazy bets.
Because, let's get real here. I don't even know the odds. I didn't do no research, but it's like probably 1 in a billion. I don't know. To get the bracket
right. perfect the all the way through? Full
perfect bracket is like one in a billion. I don't know. It's probably, I don't know the exact. Someone's I'm probably comment sure the somewhat, actual.
Yeah, I would bet some asshole out there did get one year.
Yeah, no, someone's done it. I know someone has.
Yeah.
But it's so tough because there's so many upsets and there's so many different variables that go into play. And honestly, I filled out a bracket just for the hell of it because I like competing.
Yeah.
But I don't follow college basketball at all, so it was all guessing for me.
Yeah, I was just about to confess, like, hey, look, you know what? I'm sorry, I don't get into college basketball very much.
There's so many fucking schools.
People are going to want to march down with fucking pitchforks and torches. How can you not like college basketball? I don't really dig fucking college sports very much. I just don't. But
it's just
I will
too
say,
much to follow, man.
And now March Madness, it's fun. You know, everyone feels like, everybody feels about it. Even if you don't follow it, everyone does it because it's a fun thing. Now, but I gotta say this, man, about March Madness. I think it's one of the worst ways to crown a champion. You're talking about a one game elimination in basketball to determine a champion. And people wonder why there's always upsets. In the first round, a 12 seed, you know, beats a fucking, what, fifth seed and shit like that.
Yeah.
You know, crazy shit like that happens because in basketball, you know, if it's a one-game elimination, anything can fucking happen. So I think it's just one of the worst ways to crown a champion. But I will say this. It is one of the funnest. You're talking about one-game elimination for basketball. It's fun because it is madness. It truly is madness because anything can happen.
Yeah.
Now.
Yeah, and I completely agree, man. It's crazy because I don't understand. Like, I know there are some people that follow college sports. There's so many fucking teams. I don't understand how someone can do it. I do follow a little bit, and I do like to watch the big time games, the big time you know, schools play each other. Obviously, I'm a Texas guy, so I like to see Texas teams play. But it's just so much, but it is exciting because everybody is watching it.
And you know, I understand people who used to love it back in the day, up until like the 90s, because now everyone's one and done, right? If you're a decent player, you're one and done, you're going to the NBA. But, you know, back in the day, like, especially the 80s, do you know how many fucking ESPN 30 for 30s there are about about college basketball teams from the 1980s? And if you haven't seen the one of Advance and Survive, the one about NC State winning the national title against Houston that had Akeem Olajuwon and Clyde Drexler. You know, those were some great teams with great players who would stay for like, you know, 3-4 years, you know? Michael Jordan with North Carolina and Patrick Ewing in Georgetown. It was ridiculous. The talent was it was just insane. And they would be there for 3-4 years, you know, developing these huge rivals. That's not happening now, really, right?
So, it's a new team almost every year.
But I understand why some people get into it. There's a lot of people who get into it. But it's just not really a thing for me. I really only tune. I'm one of those guys who tunes in during March Madness. Now, having said that, let's talk about some of the things that have happened so far in this year's tournament, right? So, Northwestern, they get their first tournament victory ever by beating Vanderbilt. Did you see how Vanderbilt lost that game?
No, because I was actually at work.
So Matthew Fisher Davis of Vanderbilt, right? They're up by 1 point, and he fouls Northwestern with like, I think, 14 seconds left in the game. He intentionally fouls because he thinks that Vanderbilt is down. He thinks his team is down when they're actually up. And so he intentionally fouls, sending Northwestern to the free throw line, and then they go up, and the game is over right after that. And Northwestern—that's how Northwestern ended up winning against Vanderbilt for their first ever victory in the tournament.
Wow!
And this dude was like, "Oh man, I feel bad for this dude because like he really thought that he was that their team was up." It kind of reminds me of Chris Webber. If you don't know what I'm talking about, Chris Webber with the Fab Five, he did something similar too. He called a timeout. He fucked up. This guy is probably going to live with this forever. It was terrible.
I look at this like if a player's not knowing the situation, that's on the coaches because I feel like the coaches are out there screaming like, hey, do this or do that, right? Like that, especially in the final seconds, like you're telling them what defense you want them to play, what to do, what not to do. I figure at that point you're telling them don't foul or don't do this or do that. Like, where was the communication? And I don't know. There's so many variables that go into play. Emotions, people are fired up. I don't know. That's a fucking worst way to lose a fucking game, though.
Yeah, I feel bad for that dude, but it was a stupid mistake. Another thing that happened was Middle Tennessee. They beat Minnesota. A 12 seed beat Minnesota, 81-72. They were in the lead the whole pretty much the entire game, and they were actually a popular pick by Las Vegas. They were favored to win by a point and a half. But you know, still, it's pretty ballsy for people to pick Middle Tennessee to beat Minnesota, but they did, and they did so fucking
convincingly.
Man.
Yeah, I did pick them. That's one of the upsets.
It was ferocious. These guys were intense as fuck.
A lot of people are picking them as like the Cinderella story this year, and that's the only reason I picked them to win.
These guys were like extremely intense. Like wow, pressure like a motherfucker in that game. Also, USC Trojans, they play basketball? They upset SMU.
And SMU was a
took out 6 seed SMU 66-65, 1 point.
That fucked up, man. I picked USC to lose that one, so I picked SMU to go on.
Me too.
And that hurts. But hey, that's what the madness is all about, right?
Anything Rhode Island, 11 seed, they beat the Blue Jays, the Creighton Blue Jays. I don't know how you say that. The 6 seed, they beat them 84-72. So that was another upset.
Couldn't believe it. I did not pick that. I picked that one wrong too.
Sean, give me your final four. What's your final four in your bracket? Do you know?
Oh yes, I have my paper right here.
Okay. Give me your final four, and then give me who you got winning in the championship game.
All right, my final four is Gonzaga versus Butler.
Okay.
Okay. Other side, I have Baylor versus Kansas.
Baylor versus Kansas.
Yep. And the championship
going on to the title
game. In the championship game, I have Gonzaga versus Kansas. So both number one seeds. I know, which is very hard and very rare to do, but we're gonna have two number one seeds in there, and I pick Gonzaga to win it.
Okay. Yeah. I got Gonzaga over Villanova. I got Kansas over UNC, North Carolina. And then I got, in the championship game, I got Kansas over Gonzaga being the national title champions. So I got Kansas. Yeah, you got Gonzaga. Same teams in the championship game. But anyway.
But I'm going to be right. You're going to be wrong.
I'm sure we'll talk more about March Madness next week, but it's been crazy. We'll see how it goes.
See how lucky we are.
Yep. All right. So, LeVar Ball, Sean. LeVar Ball has been everywhere. He's been on every sports outlet, just talking. Let me go over some of the bullet points of the crazier things that he has said. All right, so LeVar Ball, the father of Lonzo Ball, who plays with UCLA, and he also has two younger boys who are in high school. So he said that Lonzo is better than Steph Curry, the MVP Steph Curry. Lonzo also went on to say that he would beat Michael Jordan in his prime, and he would shut him down, and that if Michael Jordan even missed a shot, that would be it. That would be over. Charles Barkley, he took shot at Charles Barkley. He said if Charles Barkley had the same mindset as LeVar Ball, he would have won a championship if he had his attitude. And then he even challenged him to a one-on-one. And then Charles Barkley came out and was like, "Get the fuck out of here! You averaged 2.2 points a game in high school, in college. Fuck out of here!" Charles Barkley just tore him up over Twitter. Also says that all the great players like Michael Jordan and LeBron James, whose son is currently a really good player, he says that all the great players' sons are whack, and. I don't know why he went out and said that. And then he also said that he wants a $1 billion shoe deal. Actually, he wants it to be co-branded with his Triple B brand. And this would cover all three of his sons. He wants a $1 billion shoe deal. What the fuck? What do you think about all that? Do you think he's joking? Do you think he's
being serious? He's just a fucking idiot. I think he's just doing this to get TV time. I think he's doing it for his son to get more publicity. But this guy, he cannot be serious. First off, there's no way you could shut down Michael Jordan. There's no way you'll be able to put up – if you only average 2 points in college and you think you're going to go against one of the greatest defenders in Jordan, which a lot of people have got to realize, Jordan was one of the greatest defenders in the game. And you're going to say that once you get the ball, it's over? That's just stupid to me. And then he takes a jab at Charles Barkley. This guy, I think, is just trying to get as much TV time as he can. I don't know what he's talking about, $1 billion shoe deal. Get out of here. Get out of here.
Now, do you think LeVar Ball saying all this stuff, now he boosts his kids up. They're the greatest players. They're the best. They're the best of the best. Now, Lonzo, he's going to be going into the draft, this coming up draft.
Yeah.
So, do you think him saying all this paints a huge target on his son's back once he gets into the league?
Yeah.
Because even Steve Kerr came out and said that. He was like, hey, man, you need to chill out with that. So actually, a lot of people said it, but Steve Kerr recently came out and said, like, you know, when he comes into the league, he's going to put a huge target on Lonzo's back. People are going to want to go for him.
A lot of pressure on him. You know, they're going to really test him.
Now, apparently, Lonzo and all his boys, they're fine with it. But at the same time, he kind of speaks for them. He kind of talks for them. I don't know if you've ever seen interviews with him. They try to ask for his son's opinions, and they're just like, whatever dad says. That's basically how it goes. Whatever dad says. And Lonzo's like, they'll never talk again. They never speak against me. Like, they'll never back talk me, because if they did, they're not my sons. And I'd tell them to fuck off. Like, go away. They're not my kids. They would never do that. Like, this dude is crazy. Now I get, he has a lot of confidence in his sons. That's awesome and everything like that. But I think he's actually, you know, it might be smart. It might be smart.
It's smart because he's getting publicity. That's all.
Yeah, he's getting publicity. Maybe he's angling for a TV deal, you know, a reality TV show. I mean, LeVar Ball is everywhere. Everyone's talking about LeVar Ball. Like, everyone's talking about Lonzo Ball. All of them.
Doesn't he have like a hashtag on Twitter or something like that?
Yeah. Maybe he ends up. What if he gets that $1 billion shoe deal? Doesn't hurt.
I would shit bricks. Because that's fucking ridiculous.
And we'll see what Lonzo Ball comes into the league. I mean, that's going to be really interesting next year.
We've both watched his highlights, and he's a great player. He's got a lot of talent.
He's getting compared to Jason Kidd. I mean, this dude carves up defense. He's got great vision.
Yeah, he's got a lot of talent. So I just hope he can handle that pressure, because there's going to be a lot of pressure on him now. And a lot of teams are going to be like, you know, when they look at him, they're also going to be thinking about his dad. So I think that kid
– his dad will probably be there. Good. Okay.
Yeah, it could be good or it could be bad. Depends on what the teams think of that distraction, because it's going to be a distraction.
Yeah.
At the end of the day. So we'll see.
Now, have you seen the hashtag LeVar Ball says? Have you been following that at all? Because let me tell you something.
I saw a couple articles.
It is great stuff. It is phenomenal. Yeah. It's fucking hilarious. And it's best thing to come out of all of this. I'm going to name you my top five hashtag LeVar Ball says.
Oh, Lord.
These are my top five that I thought was hilarious. All right. Number one, he can speak Braille and hear sign language. Hashtag LeVar Ball says. All right. Hashtag LeVar Ball says he would have defeated Voldemort in book one. LeVar Ball says he can divide any number by zero. Hashtag LeVar Ball says he could have beaten the 92 Dream Team 1-on-5. Because apparently he could beat Barkley and Jordan. So, fuck it.
Oh, my God.
And then last one, hashtag LeVar Ball says, if Hillary was his son, she would have won. I thought those were hilarious.
Those are pretty good ones. I like that. Those are awesome. I love. Wow.
And it's not gonna stop anytime soon.
Ball says.
But you guys, let us know what you think about the whole LeVar Ball situation. Yeah. Do you think
he has some funny ones too?
Do you think he's stupid or do you think he's a marketing genius? Let us know in the comments down below. And I can't wait to Lonzo Ball get into the league next year and see what happens there.
Dude, this is probably going to be my favorite set of comments this video. Because I want to see other...
Give us your best ones. I want to see them. I love reading these LeVar Ball says.
LeVar Ball says. I'm excited now.
All right. LaMarcus Aldridge, after being diagnosed with a minor heart arrhythmia and being out indefinitely this time last week... And there was no telling, you know, out indefinitely, you know, there's no telling when he's going to come back or if he does come back.
Oh, man.
I mean, a heart arrhythmia, you don't play around with that shit. Well, he's back.
For like a whole year. Chris Bosh is not like a year with this shit.
He is back. He only missed a couple of games. He came back Wednesday night. He struggled a little bit. He looked a little bit rusty. But, Sean, I got to ask, man, with LaMarcus Aldridge back, Kevin Durant still out. Are the San Antonio Spurs the best team now for sure? And do you think they'll catch the number one seed?
Yes, 100%. Yes.
As of right now, they're a game and a half.
Yeah, I am 100% confident, no doubt in my mind, that y'all are going to finish number one and top seed in the West, which sucks because I wanted Dallas to sneak into the eighth spot, and I don't want to play y'all.
I think y'all are the best. When he said y'all. He's referring to I also love the San Antonio Spurs. I grew up in San Antonio. I don't have a banner because I can't find one. So Spurs.
You're failing at life right now, Josh. But yeah, Josh is a big Spurs fan. I'm a big Mavs fan. We've had so many games we've gone to, or even watched at the bar screaming at each other. It's been awesome. But we both respect each other's teams, and that's why I think y'all are going to be the number one team.
Do you think they'll be better than Houston though?
No, oh, yeah.
Houston's
good. But to me, San Antonio's better overall well-rounded. Houston's live and die by the three.
San Antonio's got two-way players.
Spurs
Kawhi
got two.
Kawhi Leonard.
Oh, my God. That guy can easily be MVP of the season. Ooh. I think, obviously, Westbrook or Harden, but we both know, we've talked about that in other videos, it could easily be Leonard. He's already won, you know, finals MVP. Why not, you know, NBA – you know, finals.
LaMarcus Aldridge coming back for the San Antonio Spurs.
Oh, man, I know you were so scared. Ooh. I remember when you texted me, and you're like, dude, Aldridge. And I was like, what happened? You're like, dude, I got to make a video. And you did that video, and...
Oh, man, I was so dead tired, and I was so depressed. I was like, no.
You were so depressed, and I was shocked.
The red just went down. Why did this happen?
I was in shock, man, because we really thought that he was not coming back for a long ass time, because Bosch went through this and he was out for like over a year.
Well, he's got blood clots too.
Maybe multiple things. That could have been why.
It's a little more serious.
Yeah,
actually a lot more.
But
serious.
Yeah, it was probably a little bit more serious. You're right. I remember Bosch had something with that heart thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, dude, that's great. He's back because y'all just signed him to a big contract. I was thinking that too. Like, damn, y'all just signed him and now he's hurt and he might not play for a while. I was like, that sucks. But it looks good. You know, he's back. He'll get his rhythm back, and y'all will be the number one seed, and y'all will be the best team.
Yeah, I think so, too, because, I mean, they're 1.5 games back from the Warriors. They still have one more game to play with the Warriors, and the only notable teams that they got left to play are the Cavs once. They play Portland, and they play Utah twice. And I'm sorry, but I don't – the Clippers are just falling, so I don't count them. I think that's going to be an easy win. And so I think the rest
y'all
of the schedule –
Y'all play Dallas anytime soon?
Yeah, they also play Dallas. But
we should probably go to that game, Josh. Just saying.
Probably go see maybe the MVP of the league, Kawhi Leonard. Who knows?
Let's go.
But I definitely think LaMarcus Aldridge coming back puts San Antonio as the number one, and I think they will get that actual number one seed, go into the playoffs as the team to beat, even over Houston, even if Durant comes back during the playoffs. I think San Antonio can take him out, because I don't think Durant will be 100% if they were to meet in the playoffs. But that's if the Warriors last that long. So great news for LaMarcus Aldridge. Very happy that it wasn't anything too serious, and he's back on the court. That's good for him. Good for the San Antonio Spurs. Guys, let us know what you think about LaMarcus Aldridge coming back. Does this does this put them now, you know, now that they got that out of the way, San Antonio, the number one team to beat in the West? Let us know. And we'll see what happens, because conference the playoffs are coming up pretty soon.
Yep.
All right. Dwayne Wade is out for the rest of the season. An MRI revealed a small fracture and a sprain in his right elbow, and he is out of commission for the rest of the season.
So John, sad.
Do you think this is the last time, that was the last game that we saw Dwayne Wade in a Bulls uniform?
Yes, but not just a Bulls uniform. I think this is his last, if he's really out for the season, which he is with that fracture and all that, I think he's retiring. He's had injury concerns the last like 3-4 years. I think he's going to retire. You know, he's had a good run. He tried to give it a shot in Chicago. That's his hometown. And obviously they're about to have to click the reset button and let everybody go anyways. I think they're going to let Wade go.
Definitely.
So, you know, he's already had an issue with the front office with them suspending him for calling out the team. You know, whatever. That's another video. But I think he's done in Chicago. I think he's going to retire, and he should. He's had a great career. Wade has been a phenomenal player for a very long time. He beat Dallas in the NBA Finals. I still hate him for that, but we got our revenge later on with LeBron, which is a little bit better. But I think Wade's had a great career, phenomenal, and I think he should hang it up, man.
If Dwayne Wade hangs it up, you know, that would be – he would be the first of the 2003 – of the big dogs, and then LeBron James, Carmelo Anthony, Chris Bosh, to retire, if he were to retire. But I don't think he is. I don't think he's going to retire. I think he's
really?
Gonna find, I think he's going to find another team, because nothing about him seems like he's ready to hang it up. I think he'll come back next year. Fuck. He better not come. He better not go to the goddamn Golden State Warriors. Or maybe he goes to the Cleveland Cavaliers. I don't know. But I could see he's going to be playing somewhere else next year, but not in a Bulls uniform. And I also feel bad for Jimmy Butler, because once again, Jimmy Butler has to put everything on his own shoulders. Once again, the Bulls are in 10th place as of right now, and they're just going to fall more because that team is they're in a mess right now. Dwayne's gone. Get rid of Rondo. Come on.
They got to get rid of that whole – the front office people. They got to hit the reset button for the whole fucking thing.
But I will say this, though. It was pretty cool seeing Dwayne Wade coming to Chicago, putting on a Bulls uniform. He had some good games. He gave us some really good highlights throughout the year. And he was able to play for his hometown city. And it was cool seeing him in a Bulls uniform for even just a brief period of time. You guys in the comments, let us know what you think about Dwayne Wade, him being out for the rest of the season. Do you think he's going to retire, like Sean was saying, or do you think he'll be playing next year, and where could he be possibly playing next year?
It when we don't agree on something, Josh, because it's awesome for me to be right and you're wrong. So
We'll see what happens. You guys let us know what you guys think, and we'll find out. All right, Sean.
Oh, it's our last topic.
Once again, Floyd Mayweather and Conor McGregor are in the headline news in the sports this week. Floyd Mayweather came out earlier and said, hey, I'm out of retirement, and I'm only coming out of retirement for one reason only, and that's to fight Conor McGregor and nobody else. He came out and said that. You texted me that, and I was like, wow, he said that? And you're like, yeah, he said that. Like, isn't that crazy? And I was like, yeah, that's crazy. But it's bullshit. I think it's bullshit. Him coming out and saying that is nothing new. This is something that Floyd Mayweather does. He likes to come out and in these types of situations. He did that with Pacquiao for a long time. He likes to come out and say, hey, I'm all for it. Let's do it. Because he wants to put it out there. He wants to put it out there for everyone to know, like, hey, I'm for it. So if it doesn't happen, blame that other guy. But something else interesting happened. Dana White, the head of the UFC, he came out and said on Conan O'Brien show, he said, I do think this match will happen. This is Dana White, the guy who would have to give a blessing to Conor McGregor and let him go fight for, you know, in boxing, in another, for another promotion or whatever. Yep. He came out and said that. And I think that was genius because Dana White is basically calling now Floyd Mayweather's bluff now. Floyd Mayweather comes out and says, hey, I'm down to fight. Let's see what he has to say. And Dana White, the promoter of UFC, says, yeah, it's going to happen. Now, what say you, Floyd Mayweather? So, Sean, do you think this match will finally happen? Do you think the wheels are turning in the right direction? Or do you think it's just all bullshit and just taking jabs at each other to try to blame the other if this match never happens?
You know, I could easily see Mayweather doing it for the publicity. I could. And you have a good point. I really hope it happens because I would love...
He's training right now. Mayweather.
I really fucking hope McGregor could get in the ring with Mayweather. Woo. Now, do I think it's going to happen? I don't know. Because we've seen Mayweather give the runaround with so many fighters, Pacquiao especially. Of course, he would wait until Pacquiao was pretty much out of his prime and retired and doing politics and stuff like that. So I'm not sure. And we already know what he did to Pacquiao the very first round when they were supposed to fight. You know, he gave all those stipulations and made him, you know, do this and do that and this and that. And it was ridiculous. And I don't know, man. I want it to happen, but I don't know. I still don't know. Like,
this
I can't
is so Mayweather. Interesting because, you know, Mayweather, he likes to call on people's bluffs. That's what he was trying to do. That's what he was really accomplishing, right? He's like, he puts it out there, like I said. But here's the thing, though. You called out somebody who's very similar in personality-wise to Mayweather. He called out Conor McGregor. This dude don't give a fuck. Like, he'll fight you, even if it's your professional sport. He'll come to his...
He already said he would.
He'll come to his ring in his city, Las Vegas. Conor McGregor's a crazy motherfucker. And Dana White, he's all for it. So...
Because he knows he's going to be bringing that money.
I think he called the bluff on the wrong son of a bitch. Because Conor McGregor is the one crazy son of a... He'll fight him in a parking lot. I believe that. He'll fight him in a damn parking lot. And if and they were to actually find a parking lot,
realizes that.
If it did happen in the parking lot, bro, no doubt in my mind, Conor McGregor will kick his ass.
Of course.
But anyway, so like now, if this were to happen, who do you think would be the bigger draw, Mayweather or McGregor?
Who would be the?
I think I'll tell you right now.
I don't know.
I think no doubt in my mind. Conor McGregor is the bigger draw. Why? Because Floyd Mayweather, he's a huge, massive, massive draw here in America. But so is Conor McGregor. But he's also a huge draw globally. This guy's a huge draw. So if they were to fight, this would be for a huge, insane amount of money. Floyd Mayweather is probably going to want like 60% of the cut, maybe even 70%, something stupid to try to get Conor McGregor to back out, right? Something like a low ball. And I hope Conor McGregor says, fuck it, I don't care. I'll still fight you. You know, just keep calling on the shit. Like, no, I'll fight you. I'll fight you. I hope that happens, but we'll see. But I think
Conor McGregor
is no doubt the bigger draw. And I do wish this fight will happen because I'm a fan of Conor McGregor. I like how he is. I just like how he just doesn't give a fuck.
He'll get in your face, man.
I would really love. I mean, and Conor McGregor, time and time again, his opponents, they just don't get how fast he is, how strong he is, and how hard he hits until they get into the octagon with him. Then I mean, every time. After the fight, they're like, I didn't think he was that fast. I didn't think he hit that hard. Conor McGregor.
He's a bad motherfucker,
He's a sneaky dude, and who knows? You got to give the edge to Mayweather, right? Because he's the professional boxer here. But Conor McGregor's pretty fucking fast. And if he gets to Mayweather.
And let's get real here. Mayweather, he's a more of a counter guy. So it's not like
defensive guy. He plays the cards. McGregor. If Conor McGregor gets him in the corner and he starts hitting him in the head, he can knock him the fuck out.
Man, I'm getting so excited because I fucking hate Mayweather, and I hope he gets his ass whooped.
McGregor, I hope he makes this happen. Call Mayweather on his bluff. Call him on his shit. But anyway, that's our thoughts. Guys, let us know what you think about this. Do you think Floyd Mayweather is calling them out on their bluff? Do you think that's all it is? Do you think this match will happen? And who you got winning this fight? But let us know in the comments down below. And I can't wait to see what else comes out of this.
Yeah.
But, all right. Well, that's it. That's it for the Weekly Fury. It was a long show, but it was a great one. We had a whole bunch of stuff. You guys, let us know in the comments what you guys thought about all these topics, about Zeke, the Cowboys, the Patriots.
We had some good topics this week.
Mayweather, McGregor. Yeah. I mean, Dwayne Wade out for the season. So it's just been a crazy week of sports, and I had a blast talking about it.
Still so much more to come.
Man. Who knows what next week's going to bring? Maybe Tony Romo actually gets a team. Maybe Adrian Peterson finally finds a team.
I want to talk about that. So, so yeah, we'll see. Like I said, there's still a lot to come. AP, Jamal Charles, Tony Romo. There's so much to talk about, and I'm excited. I am excited. So,
guys, thanks for watching. Be sure to like, comment, and subscribe, and share this video if you enjoyed it. And we'll see you next week.
Yeah. Till next time.